United States. Everybody knows the Toyota story of success, and Jim Press has been part of that story starting in 1970 when he first joined Toyota Motor Sales. Fortune magazine said it best when they called him Toyota's secret weapon, saying he arguably has as much influence over the course of the American auto industry as anyone else alive. Ladies and gentlemen, it is my pleasure, Mr. Jim Press, President, Chief Operating Officer, Toyota Motor Sales.
Thank you. Thank you. Good morning.
Thank you very much.
It's hard to follow a journalist getting an award,
especially one that knows, has a good sense of humor. Thank you very much. Good morning, everybody. It's a real honor to be here. And it's also an opportunity to express appreciation to all of you that are here that help with the success and the accomplishments of our company. I'm really especially pleased to have so many of our dealers here, and I want to say thank you very much, because to me that's the real secret of our success, is the strength of our dealer organization, especially here in the heartland. I also want to welcome you to the official opening of another enticing Chicago auto show. This is one of the best auto shows in the world as far as I'm concerned. There are many exciting things to see and talk about, so I'm really glad we're all here to get started. I'd also like to thank the Midwest Automotive Media Association for sponsoring this media preview event now for 15 years. And it was really good that you kept getting your members up and down. That's their morning exercises, especially those that are older. I heard them creaking a little bit when they got up. I enjoyed your story that you told about this young person. I expected you were going to say that was your granddaughter that was talking to you. You're doing a great job of getting things off to a great start. I'd like to also congratulate the Chicago Automotive Trade Association for organizing this show and for recently earning recognition as one of the top international auto shows. Congratulations. It's about time, really. At Toyota, we've recognized the importance of this breakfast for quite a while, as well as the show. Dave Ellingworth, who is a key architect of the Lexus brand, was one of the first keynote speakers for the Mama Breakfast back in 1994. We consider the show so vital that over the next 2 days, we're going to unveil two of the most important products that we've ever brought to the market. The all-new Lexus ES350 will be introduced right after the breakfast, and then tomorrow morning at 9, the next-generation Tundra. Now, if you looked around at all before you came in, you might think we took over the place through this exhibit that you have outside. If not, you'll see it on the way out. We took over a nice exhibit to show the complement of how the Tundra will fit into the lifestyle of America. We built a mini cattle ranch, a logging camp, a construction zone to create what we call the Tundra Experience. It's a fun, interactive exhibit for visitors that will show the new Tundra on the job and help people move forward in their lives. And I hope you can take a look at it after this breakfast. We also were able to plant some colorful flowers that are blooming throughout the winter haze in Chicago today and yesterday. This signals the early coming of a fresh ES this spring. You know, auto shows are a different world these days. I remember the old days when we were happy displaying a couple cars with some nice velvet ropes. But auto show displays, like the cars themselves, have progressed tremendously since 1970 when I started hanging around. And both keep getting better every year. That's why, despite today's headlines and everything that we see going on, I've got to say that I'm very optimistic about the future of our business. And I firmly believe that our best days are still well ahead of us, especially in the automotive industry. And that's what I want to talk about this morning. The coming boom in our business and the ways that we can give our customers more of what they want and how we can work together as an industry to overcome the challenges that might threaten our bright future. Now, in his State of the Union message last Tuesday, President Bush shared some ideas about curbing America's oil addiction, including further development of ethanol, flex fuel vehicles, hybrids, and some other advanced technologies.
We like these things, and we think it's very positive that the nation has a spotlight shining on the development of alternative solutions for power rate automobiles. We share that commitment at Toyota. We're spending about $7 billion a year on research and development to help perfect advanced propulsion technologies and fuels for the future. The fact is, our goal is to be deeply involved in this national products to reduce both fuel consumption as well as emissions. As successful technologies emerge, Toyota will be there, along with every other auto manufacturer that's represented in this room. As an industry, we're working very hard on this effort. So let's talk a little bit about this coming boom in the business that we see. The industry just came off the third best year in history. January sales were up about 8% over last year. We don't have an ailing industry. There are a few companies that are on the road to recovery, and we will all be able to benefit as the tide rises from improved industry outlook. All companies are learning quickly what they need to do. They're taking bold action. They're developing much better products, services, and action plans for the future. At Toyota, we're cautiously optimistic. We're projecting total annual industry sales for 2006 of 17.2 million, up about 1%. Now, that may not sound like too much, but plus sales are always welcome and would be the industry's second best year in history. For the long term, we believe annual sales of 20 million are within reach in the next decade. The whole industry will benefit from the rising market tide.
It's his phone.
We believe business will boom again because, frankly, demographics and economic forces
in our favor. And the fact is, they're getting better every single day. I'll tell you why. First of all, people are living longer and driving longer. At 78 million strong, the baby boomers are alive and well, and they're living to an average age of over 77. This generation grew up in their cars. They love the freedom automobiles provide, and they're not going to give them up anytime soon. A lot of people are buying cars in their 90s. They're going out and buying an additional vehicle. C&W Research says that seven vehicles, that's more than half of the 13 vehicles that are bought in a lifetime, are bought in a household where the head is over 50 years of age. And when you realize that 60% of the population will be 50 or older in the next 5 years, well, and those same people control over half of all consumer spending, $2 trillion a year, you can see the enormous opportunity that lies ahead. And that's not all. The best part is this economic juggernaut is still in first gear. Baby boomers won't reach the height of their spending power until 2009. So hang on, it's going to be a great ride. The good news is it doesn't end with 2009. Generation Y, the second largest generation of all time, will start flexing their muscles by 2010, buying one out of every four new cars. In fact, as throughout this decade, 63 million Gen Y consumers are coming of driving age, getting their driver's licenses. 63 million new people are getting their driver's licenses in the next 10 years. Think about that. First of all, don't drive after midnight. And if the left turn signal is on, they're probably going to turn right. The fact is, if you ever get depressed about our business and the outlook for the industry, sometimes you can do what I do. I'll take a Sunday afternoon and I'll go to the maternity ward at a hospital. I don't know if you've ever been to that. It's kind of a fun place. First of all, isn't it a great place to be? Everybody's happy and they're celebrating a new life. But if you stand there and look at the window there, those little baskets, the pink and blue baskets, each one of those baskets is 13 purchase cycles. You know, it's a really a wonderful opportunity. It's a great industry that we're in. Right now, as we're having this breakfast, there are people creating new customers for us just waiting. 63 million Gen Y consumers. I can't believe that number, but the fact is, if you go out there and look at driver's license tests and people buying new cars, you'll believe it. And that's one of the reasons the number of our industry has been so high lately. These Gen Y consumers are richer. They've got more purchasing power than any previous generation. It really is one of the reasons that we've been hovering around the 17 million mark year after year. Now, all of these trends will be joined by another strong movement, immigration. America continues to be the land of opportunity. And when you put all of these forces together, the result is astounding. During the next 19 years, the population of the United States will increase by 70 million. In 19 years, that's equal to the population of California, New York, and Florida all combined. We're going to be adding additional customers. It means we're adding one new person to the economy every 14 seconds. So since Jim got his award, a short time ago, 160 people have joined the marketplace. American Demographics Magazine says the population spurt in the next two decades is so strong it will rival the growth America experienced right after World War II. And of course, we know what happened when all those lonely soldiers came home from war. They created the original baby boom. So being the optimist that I am, I foresee the day in the not-too-distant future when another huge boom generation, maybe we'll call it Gen Z for now, will arrive on the scene and drive our business even higher. Now, along with phenomenal demographics, market drivers are also on our side. The GDP, consumer spending are positive, jobs increasing, productivity is rising. A lot of experts now believe a new tech boom will significantly stimulate our economy as new information technologies build out, mature, and become a bigger part of our everyday lives. We're already seeing this evidence with the iPodding of America. Digital music, video, they're everywhere in our pockets, phones, TVs, computers, Palm Pilots. We're even putting a hard drive in the dash of the new Lexus LS460. And that's just the beginning. Did you know, for instance, that the number of cell phone text messages sent in the U.S. tripled in the past 2 years to 38 billion text messages? And only 7 of those were sent by somebody over 17. The adoption phase of this information age is all coming together as a revolution in biotech and nanotechnology create the potential for a strong new economy in the coming years. All of these positive trends are why I'm so bullish on America and this industry. The fact is, people love cars here. We now in the United States, we have more cars per household than people. It's a great place to live. Okay. So now that we know the future looks bright, how do we build the road to tomorrow's success? I think it starts with taking better care of our customers by providing the products they really want. And you know, it's funny. I often get asked, what's the secret to Toyota's success? Like it's some big, dark mystery. The answer is really simple. We find out what customers want. We try to give it to them through the best dealers in the industry. And that's it in a nutshell. We do what we do best, design and build great cars, and we trust and rely on our dealers to take care of sales and customer satisfaction and the customer at the end. So how do we deliver what customers want and desire through products? Well, the first thing we do is we listen to the customers very carefully. The second thing is we watch them interact with their vehicles. And then third, we take the actions to add the desired elements that they want in their new products. Like the new ES350 you'll see here in a moment. It's always been a top seller for us, but we knew it could be better. So in developing the next generation, we talked and listened extensively to our Lexus customers, as well as luxury customers in general. We found that people genuinely liked the current ES, but thought it was a little conservative in both style and performance. Most considered it classy, solid, and comfortable, but they really couldn't get excited about it. We discovered that near-luxury buyers viewed their cars as a symbol of their success, so they want a car that is fast and eye-catching, a sedan that will bring them recognition for achieving a high level of professional and financial achievement. And that's not all. At the same time, they told us they wanted their car to enhance their sense of well-being by comforting and pampering them with special amenities. That's a tall order, but, well, we worked hard, and you're going to see their desires and harmony came together in just a few minutes. The second way we find out what customers want is through watching them closely as they interact with their vehicles. There's no substitute for spending time with customers while they're spending time with their vehicles. A prime example of that is the new Tundra that you'll see tomorrow. We had a very good success with the current Tundra. We've sold a lot more than we could make every year it's been on the market. But at the same time, to create the new one, we went right back to our customers to find out what they wanted in a full-size pickup today. They told us they loved the ride and feel of the current Tundra, and it performed admirably in recreational and light-duty use. But some customers told us that they considered it more of a city truck, and they wanted a work truck. They said they needed more power, more pull, more payload to get their jobs done. So with this in mind, we observed how real people were using their trucks to earn a living. Our Japanese and American designers and engineers and product planners didn't just go and see the market. They lived in the market. You name it, we did it. I'm talking about customer visits to their homes, construction sites, mining camps, ranches, farms, truck stops, tax stores, tow hitch shops, car carrier companies, even drilling sites. We sent them out for 2 weeks at a time in fifth-wheel trailers on 1,000-mile camping trips, where they did what typical American families do all the time, argue from the back seat to the front. They also spent time with personal and recreational use truckers. They saw trailer hitches being installed. They got in the cabs and rode on the big rigs. They drank coffee served by big-haired waitresses who called them hun. They did everything they could to live in the shoes and work with their customers. And then we used that knowledge to develop the next Tundra. For example, during ranch visits, we noticed the difficulty drivers encountered when lining up their tow hitch with the trailers they wanted to pull. Many needed a third person to guide them through the process. So on the new Tundra, we're going to have a widescreen rear backup camera hidden in the tailgate handle to serve as an extra pair of eyes, making trailer hookups a lot easier and smoother, as well as safer backing up. That's just one example of the many new features that make up the vehicle that we have as Tundra, a full-blown workhorse. Now, as I said earlier, there's no deep, dark secret involved with these product developments. It's just a strong desire to listen, observe, learn, and take action to give the customer what they want. Customers always have to come first. Any automaker can do the same thing, and those that do are thriving and taking advantage of this golden era. So now that we know there are good times ahead and we're armed with some key ways to attract new customers, how can we solidify our standing of vital industry for the 21st century? I believe it starts with making sure we begin taking responsibility as an auto industry for helping society solve some of the problems that could be spawned by the great success of the auto industry. We have to ensure the industry continues to be a boon and not become a burden to society. America's great love affair with the automobile could slip into reverse if we're not careful. Today, there are 750 million cars on the roads worldwide, and we're selling 170,000 more every single day. That's the average output of an average assembly plant. Every day, we're adding 170,000 cars to the load of the planet. The number of cars on American roads alone will double in the next 20 years. These are sheer numbers, but the impact is incredible on the air we breathe, the roads we travel, the congestion, the world we live in. So some people are beginning to question whether their cars, their old trusted friends, might be becoming a problem in the quality of their lives and for those of the future generation. It's a pivotal time for the industry. While there's been good progress on air pollution, the EPA still reports that half the U.S. population lives in areas where unhealthful levels of smog exist. Cars are responsible for only a third of the smog in urban areas, but they're very visible targets, and we can't escape being part of the clean air debate. In addition, of course, there's growing concern among the world societies about global warming. And if we don't turn this around soon, cars could become an even bigger target for criticism or regulation. The fact is, as an industry, we have to become part of the solution, not the pollution. Along with the smog and global warming, we're also facing concerns about foreign oil dependence, the depletion of oil, our primary source of energy. As a result, higher gas prices last year, people are more anxious than ever about the country's heavy reliance on foreign oil. They're realizing more and more that much of the world's oil lies in regions that are geographically remote and difficult, ecologically sensitive, or politically unstable. We have a classic case of the haves and have-nots beginning to brew. The world's three largest economies, the U.S., China, and Japan, consume almost 40% of the world's oil, and we produce less than 6% of it. And the top three countries that produce oil? Well, you can probably guess. Saudi Arabia, Iran, and Iraq. Oil is a finite, non-renewable source of energy, and when it's gone, it's gone. Many scientists and geologists now believe that we're approaching a point where the world will have used half the oil in existence. The so-called oil peak could come as early as this decade. The fact is, if you think about Mount Fuji as a cup of coffee, and think of that cup of coffee as Mount Fuji turned upside down, so far in history, we've used about 4 Mount Fujis of oil on Earth. And the experts think there may be 4.5 Mount Fujis of oil left. This so-called oil peak could come as early as this decade, and if it does, it will mark a major turning point in our history and the end of cheap oil as we know it. During the second half of the oil age, supplies won't keep up with demand and the extraction costs will escalate, forcing the price of crude to even higher levels. And even more troubling is these stark realizations are coming at a time when rapidly developing countries like China and India, plus continued high consumption in the U.S., will drive oil demand up by 40% between now and 2025. So what do we do? Well, I'm an optimist. And I think there's an awful lot that we are not only can do, but we are doing. The fact is, we now are doing more for our future than we ever have. And we're making good progress as an industry. Most of the cars today produce 99% fewer smog-forming emissions than the counterparts did in the 60s. Today's light trucks produce fewer smog-forming emissions than cars did just over a decade ago. In California, there are 20 car models offered by 12 automakers, including the Camry and the Prius, that are partial zero-emission vehicles. They're not only the cleanest gasoline engines ever produced, they're built to maintain near-zero emissions throughout their entire life on the road. But that's not enough. So we're inventing a new wave of powertrain technologies that will be coming to the market. I'm proud that Toyota was one of the companies that helped introduce the first mass-produced hybrid car, the Prius, 9 years ago. Prius is a mid-sized sedan. It delivers about twice the mileage of a conventional car and just one-tenth the emissions. More hybrids are on the way. Last year, we launched the world's first luxury hybrid, the LX400H, the Highlander, the first seven-passenger SUV. These offer the power of V8s, the mileage of a Mini Cooper, and about 80% less smog-forming emissions than regular SUVs. This year, we're going to add two more, a GS hybrid sedan and the Camry hybrid built here in America. And then early next year, we'll have a hybrid option on our flagship LS sedan. The fact is, we estimate that all the hybrids we've sold in America through last fall helped save more than 100 million gallons of gasoline, not to mention tons of smog-forming emissions. These hybrid systems work. We're not alone about confidence in the future of hybrids. Honda has three, Ford has two. Ford says that half their models will be hybrids in the next 5 years. Nissan, General Motors, Chrysler, BMW, Volkswagen, Porsche, everyone's planning to introduce gas-electric models in the very near future. As we see it, the timing couldn't be any better. Consumer consideration for buying hybrids has skyrocketed now to more than one out of every three buyers. And the reason is that people are buying hybrids for good reasons beyond just fuel economy. They realize hybrids are a simple way to make an important difference using today's technology and infrastructure to curtail foreign oil dependence, air pollution, and help greenhouse gases. And the fact is, they're a lot of fun to drive. Being able to skip gas stations is just icing on the cake. And when volumes increase, costs come down for hybrids and their components. Americans like to do the right thing, and they love doing the smart thing. And that's why hybrids really are part of our future. But as good as hybrids are, it's important to recognize that we're just beginning of a new age of advanced engine technologies. A lot more needs to be done to keep the freedoms we enjoy. Think about it. We're in a delicate situation because we live in a market where more than half of all the vehicles sold are cars, are trucks, or SUVs. We can't disregard the needs of the earth, and we can't afford to ignore the needs of our customers. So we have to find ways to strike a balance in our lineups between big trucks and SUVs on one side and super efficient hybrids, clean diesels, and eventually hydrogen fuel cell vehicles on the other. As we become at Toyota a full-line manufacturer, we're more committed than ever to our corporate vision to maximize customer satisfaction by meeting user requirements for every vehicle, but zeronize the negative impact on the environment. We're proud that according to EPA trends, based on 2005 corporate averages, Toyota vehicles achieved the best overall fuel economy of any full-line manufacturer. Toyota and Scion vehicles are rated in the top 10 of more EPA categories than any other company. That way, we can provide for all of our customers' needs while at the same time saving oil and decreasing air pollution and greenhouse gases. For the industry, all these advances will take huge cooperation among all automakers, suppliers, labor interests, governments, and other industries. We're all headed in the right direction, and we should make it our goal as an industry, everybody in this room, to be more proactive from now on, To do that, we need to create a spirit of cooperation within the industry, one where we continue to compete like the Dickens in the marketplace, but come together as one on important issues that threaten our collective future. We need to be more like the Major League Baseball group. The teams compete fiercely on the field, but they come together as a league to defend and build the value of the sport. We can do the same thing. A good place to start is by using the Alliance of Automobile Manufacturers as a rallying point, sort of like the league for the industry. In fact, in my role as the chairman of the Alliance this year, I've proposed that the Alliance begin working on an industry plan to do two key things. First, to reclaim leadership in the debate about these broad social issues and to demonstrate that the auto industry will be part of the solution. And second, to develop a long-term plan on how our industry will help America achieve energy independence. Why is this crucial? Because up to this point, we've allowed others, NGOs, politicians, to claim leadership on these issues and define the industry. We have to reassert our voice and take responsibility for being part of the solution. And by doing that, we will become the leaders, we will define the debate, and we will be recognized as a responsible industry that takes consumers to heart. It's time to stop being an against industry and to come out for something important, like a better earth and better quality of life. If we can focus on positive leadership and develop a long-term industry plan for success, we can reestablish our reputation as the world's foremost business, and we will reach even higher levels of success. In short, we can do good things and do good business at the same time. You know, it's obvious when you walk through the show, you clearly see the enormous power and the potential of this great auto industry. So now it's time to put that magic to work. Let's pull all the key leaders of the industry together, throw away our name badges and companies, leave our egos at the door, and come together to work closely as one industry to begin solving the real challenges we face. And once we develop a plan, we'll find partners to help put it into action. Everybody has a stake in these issues. Everybody that loves this business, everybody that loves cars, everybody that loves the freedom and the economic benefits that we get from this great industry can come together and take advantage of this golden era and the changeover of these new technologies. The time is now to make this change for the better. We can do it. It's possible, and our future depends on it. By working more closely together to serve our customers and society, we will not only rekindle the full strength of our industry, but will ensure a brighter, more prosperous future for ourselves, our children, and our grandchildren. I thank you very much for your attention. It's been an honor to speak with you, and I'd like to address any questions and answers that you have at this time. Thank you.